Bob, happy birthday. 80 years old. You don't look a day over 60. What a great party. What a great boss. And really enjoyed working with you and keeping the relationship going. Happy birthday, Robert.
Happy birthday, Bob. Boy, those years were fabulous years. We loved them. We loved being with you all. And Karen was just the best. We thank you.
Happy birthday, Uncle Bob. You look fabulous at 80. We're so proud of all your accomplishments you've made and have so many fun memories of all the special times.
Happy birthday, Uncle Bob.
Happy 80th birthday, Bob.
Happy birthday, Bob.
We love you.
We love you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Bob. We love you.
We do love you.
Happy
80th. Right? Happy
birthday.
What?
Say something to Grandpa.
Oh, okay. Grandpa, happy 80th.
That's your dad.
I mean, Dan, happy 80th. Love you so much. I'm not really good at speaking, but so happy that we're all together as a family tonight and enjoying this time. Chris, I love you.
Hey, Bob, Robert. Want to thank you for everything you've done for us. And don't ever lose that twinkle in your eye.
Happy 80th birthday, Grandpa. I love you so much, and thank you for always being the best grandpa ever.
Happy birthday, Grandpa. Thank you for all the opportunities that you've created for all of your family, and I know that you've become a very successful man, and I know that you became that successful for your family, and we all are very appreciative of that and all the opportunities that you've created for us and all of your family in the future. So thank you so much and happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Bob.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Dad, Grandpa, love you.
Happy birthday, Bob. It's such a pleasure to know you in the years that I've known you and to look through all of the years that you've lived with Karen and the history that you have shared with us. So happy to be here tonight, to be a part of this lovely celebration, to be a part of your family with your kids. And again, I feel very blessed to be a part of my everyday life with you.
Happy birthday, Bob, and thanks for letting us be a part of your family. We really appreciate it. Happy birthday.
So my next guest here is a man who's been on this planet for about 80 years. You all know him. He's my dad. And I'm very proud of him because he's been here for 80 years. That's a long time. 80 years. So he's here to show you his journey that he's taken over the 80 years. And we're going to start from the very, very, very beginning. And this is my dad right here as a baby. So we're going to start right there. But yeah, grab your drinks, everyone, because this is going to be a long journey. I hope everyone's ready because it's going to take a long time. But first off, I want to thank Eddie over here, because he sat with my dad for about, I would say, probably, 350 hours, sitting there going through 8,647 pictures, culling it down to 346, which you guys are about to see. So enjoy. But wait, before we're going to do that, I have some stuff here. This party was really expensive, so we're going to try to recoup. We've got some merchandise here. So we're going to sell this afterwards, everyone. You can buy this. $19.95. This is a pillow of my mom and dad here. This is $19.95. But first, we're going to start off, and I want to give this to, because I know my sister over here, Michelle, loves this picture. She loves this. And I know Chris would love to put this on his bed. So they're going to go to bed every night and look at my parents. And Chrissy, I think Chrissy would like to have one of these for her bed. So Chrissy, here, you can stare at my mom and dad every night before you go to bed with John. But I have some more. Guess what this is, everyone? It's a puzzle of Hulk Hogan and my dad. And it's got 252-piece puzzle, everyone. Oh, we dropped some pieces. Okay. So, you know, we've got more of these afterwards, but I think Gus Anastasia would like to put this puzzle together. Gus, here is a puzzle of my dad and Hulk Hogan, which is this one right here. You can take this home, because that'll help you put the puzzle together. Because it's going to be really challenging, because there's 256 pieces to put together. So enjoy. And one last thing, this is the most expensive item, but it gets cold at night sometimes. And sometimes you're gonna need a Hulk Hogan and Bob Long Snuggly. And see, these Snugglies are great because you can wrap it around just like this. And then look, wait, hold on a second. If I can do this right, I can get Bob Long, my dad. Where is he? That's Hulk Hogan. And Bob Long, well, anyway, there's a way to find Bob Long and Hulk Hogan on both shoulders, and snuggle is amazing. And I think Bill Erickson would like one of these snugglies. So Bill Erickson can snuggle with Hulk Hogan and my dad. There you go. Have fun. Okay. And without further ado, my dad, Bob Long.
Only Michael put something together like that. Thank you, Michael, and also Michelle, my daughter, worked very hard on this. So I thank you all and Eddie for putting all this together. It's a real honor to see such a great group here. You came from all over the place. We got people here from Poland. Stephen came all the way from Poland. And California. Michael, yeah. So people came from everywhere. Even one came from Venice. Venice, Florida, that is. Patrick from Venice. Couple of things I want to recognize before I get into a little presentation that Michael put together. Two people I want to give recognition to. One of them, is it up there? One of them is my granddaughter, Christina. At 2.5 years old, she saved her brother's life. Her parents, Chrissy, John and Chrissy, were at the house, at our house, and had packed up the car to head home. Before leaving, Chrissy checked on her and headed for the bathroom, and John fastened the boat to the van. John Thomas managed to squeeze through an opening in the sliding door and happened to fall in the pool. His sister, Christina, went screaming for her parents. Her mom came running, saw John Thomas lying face down in the pool. She had CPR training. She immediately pulled John Thomas from the pool out and administered CPR and revived him. He is now a tall, good-looking guy, and thanks to his sister, John Thomas, stand up, and Christina. Your sister saved you, and that was a wonderful, wonderful story. The other person I wanted to recognize was not able to make it tonight, but it's somebody who's been through a rough time. Carolina, most of you know Carolina. She had a rough start in life due to having only half a heart and many health problems. But through her prayers and Kevin and Ashley's parents' extreme care, she pulled through and now is a lovely little girl. And I was hoping she would be here, but she couldn't make it. She'd be, I think, tomorrow, right? She'd be around.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so again, I wanted to recognize those two people from the family. I think I deserve recognition. Okay, we're going to approach this a little differently. We wanted to present my life, not to brag about it, but to illustrate how we succeeded through the years. Well, if I hadn't won the lottery, it may not have been possible. No, I didn't win the Will lottery, but I won the lottery by winning the hand of a girl named Karen Hanley. In St. Louis. She has been a major part of my success. Okay, we have a wonderful group and family and friends here. We have our children and most of their spouses. We have our grandchildren, our cousins, nephews and nieces, and co-workers from the past and the present. Welcome to you all. Well, we've prepared a presentation reviewing the last 80 years of my life. 80. If it takes only 5 minutes for each year, we would get through at 5 o'clock tomorrow morning. So, but there's two reasons we wanted to put this together. And one is to share the progress and the ups and downs we have had in achieving what we did. After all, I was born during the Depression. My parents had no money to speak of. I went to small schools, lived with grandparents out in the country, and was broke. We got married, had 6 kids, put them through college. I lost my job and all income at 53 years old, but still managed a very successful life. Due to certain beliefs. Those beliefs are faith, family, working and studying hard and treating other people with trust and loyalty, and hiring good people and never giving up. Second reason was to have prepared this was to have a record of my life to pass on to descendants. So here goes. It all started in the late 1930s. Yeah, I can't see, but I trust you. You know where we are.
Do you want to turn?
No, that's all right. That's all right. He knows where we are. The late 1930s, my dad was a graduate engineer who graduated from Missouri University of Rolla. He was working for Seagram's Industry in Louisville, Kentucky. My mother, Sally, graduated from nursing school. They met during the last year of college, fell in love, and married in April 1939. I was born the following year, March 10th, 1940, at the end of the Depression. I was born in a small apartment in Louisville, Kentucky. Then when the United States entered the war, that's World War II, not Civil War. my father was an ROTC graduate, so entered the Army. He and my mother, Sally, traveled all during the war throughout the United States and lived in about 7 different states. My sister Carol, who's here, was born in Rantoul, Illinois in 1942. When the war ended in 1945, my family moved to a small town in Potosi, Missouri. My father went to work in a TIF mill. Some of you know what TIF is, others, most of you don't, but it's a mineral. And the mine is TIF. My dad then drove a Model A truck at that time, and I remember riding in the back of that old truck. In 1947, when I was 7 years old, I was sent to live with my grandparents in Cadet, Missouri. My parents wanted me to go to a Catholic school. It was worth it, I guess, but it was the loneliest time of my life. I was in the country, no other children to play with, and I became really homesick and really missed my parents and my sister, Carol. My parents' house was in Cadet, Missouri. Cadet was really a one-store town, as a few of you remember, which my grandparents owned. And it had one depot. Now, this is all entirely gone. So the town where I grew up and went to school no longer exists. When I started school, I had to walk down to the store and wait for the bus to pick me up. On the first day of school, I went down and got on the bus to get to school. But after school, I didn't know one yellow bus from the other in the first grade. So when I got out of school, I got on the first yellow bus I saw. Luckily, my uncle was the bus driver, and he says, Bobby, you're on the wrong bus. So I said, tell me which one you get on, which he did. Unfortunately, that bus made 2 other trips before it came back to school to pick me up. One of them was to Vince's house, so you were on an early bus. But I wouldn't get home till 2 or 3 hours later, after school let out. School was 4 miles from our house. I did walk that several times, but where's Patrick? I didn't walk it, as Patrick kids me all the time. I didn't walk it every day, not in the snow, uphill both ways. And we could always get home before the last bus would have dropped me off. So anyway, the cadet experience was not one of my best. 2 years later, my sister Carol started school. And my mom and dad decided to move to Cadet to be with Carol and I. That made things much better, so I continued to attend Old Mines until 7th grade. By then, Potosi had a Catholic school. So we moved back to Potosi and started a school at St. James. It was a small school with only 2 nuns for 8 grades. We had 4 grades in one room and 4 grades in another. You remember that? I graduated in the eighth grade. I did graduate in the 8th grade in the top 10 of my class. That's because there were only 10 students. 6 boys, 4 girls shown here. However, even though it's a small school, I've found that it's not necessary to always go to the best, most expensive school to succeed in life. From there, I went to St. Vincent Seminary in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. It was somewhat cloistered, and since we were only allowed to go home at Christmas and in the summer. Even though it was a good education, by junior year, I decided the priesthood was not for me. Although I've never regretted my time or the education I received there. I started at Missouri University at Rolla in engineering, like my father did. But after a year, I transferred to St. Louis University and loved it. I graduated in 1962 with an industrial engineering degree. I then started to work on my master's in business administration and went to work for McDonnell Aircraft in St. Louis, where I started working on the F-4 Phantom jets, which was quite interesting. I lived in an apartment with three other graduate students. Seen here, we're manufacturing a carpet out of carpet tray. So we had a carpet for our apartment. We had a fabulous time there, with parties almost every weekend at our apartment. Then one afternoon, at a coffee shop, I saw this beautiful girl walk in, and I said, "Who is that? I'd like to get fixed up with her." So someone tried to fix us up, and she found out she was already going with someone at that time. So a few weeks later, someone told me she had broken up, and she was available. So I said, "Please fix me up," and they did, and he did. And our first date was water skiing on the Mississippi, which my friends and I were doing practically every weekend. Karen well remembers that. At that time, she was also dating another person, a rich. A rich guy from St. Louis. So when I took her home from water skiing that first day, her hair was all wet, her mom was furious that she came home looking like that, that she had a date to go to the opera with this fellow. Anyway, when I dropped her off, I asked her for another date, and she accepted. And we continued dating. I've never seen that. There's a beer can wall, and that's that's in our apartment also, the one with the one with the carpet. Although I was not looking to get married yet, we did continue dating almost every weekend, and she finally gave me the ultimatum and said she might just start dating with the other guy. By that time, I had fallen in love and in no way wanted to lose her. So on Valentine's Day, 1964, we were engaged. And by June 1964, we were married. That was less than 1 year since that first date, and it's been wonderful ever since. Before we were married, I had decided to get a job away from St. Louis and get started on our own. I got a job with Monsanto in Pensacola, Florida. And we took our honeymoon on the way to Florida. We had basically no money, a car that was not paid for, but I did have a good job. So without money, we carried our food in a 7-Up cooler that her grandfather had given her, as you see here in the picture. And we made do very well. We got to Pensacola, Florida, we loved it. I bought a house, and then I bought a boat and rebuilt it. We went boating almost every weekend. First, I had a wooden cruiser. It had a hole in it, but I fixed that. And then I bought the old Glastron boat and rebuilt that. We had our first son, John, in Pensacola. And several of our other friends had their first child in Pensacola. We had spent, okay, then you see here, Karen hold baby John with another friend on our boat in Pensacola, where we spent every weekend. After 2 years in Pensacola and making many good friends, my job was just entirely too boring. It was manufacturing nylon strand, very boring. So I called my good friend and Randy Doan, best friend, St. Louis, and asked him if he'd get me a job at Emerson Electric, which he did. So in 1966, we moved back to St. Louis, and I started to work at Emerson Electric, building helicopter armament systems for Huey Cobra helicopters. During the Vietnam War, we were kept extremely busy, and I had over 100 people reporting to me in the Industrial Engineering Department. We also had two more children while in St. Louis. First, Patrick, and then, don't laugh. our first and only girl, Michelle, who turned out to be a beautiful girl. As the war was winding down, they gave me a very good job in the executive part of Emerson, but I wanted to find out how to build boats. So I went to the Wall Street Journal, checked the want ads, and found that Starcraft Industries in Goshen, Indiana, was looking for an engineering manager. So I took that job. We moved up to Indiana and again made many good friends. I loved the work, and one of the first things I did there was we had another child, and this is where Michael was born. I started as engineering manager, then plant manager at both plants and then fiberglass plant. And finally, to get some marketing experience, I took the job as export manager. I set up numerous overseas dealers then. I set up a plant to manufacture motorhomes in Germany. I set up an aluminum plant in New Zealand, as well as another plant in Australia. We had dealers all over the world, especially Europe, and I was traveling out of the country 11 times in 1 year with 4 kids back at home. I decided that was too much, too long being away from the family, and asked my boss for another job. He put me in charge of the motorhome plant, and I worked happily there until the president, with whom I was a good friend, was fired and someone else put in his place. I then decided I wanted a different job and went to work for Crestliner Boats in Little Falls, Minnesota. Again, building boats. Again, we made many good friends and did well in the business. One of the friends happens to be Max Spencer, who's here tonight. Mac, that is that is you, Mac. And we made many good friends. Max Spencer has been with me ever since. So I worked at Crestliner for a little over 2 years, and again, Karen became pregnant with Kevin, our fifth. We were building both aluminum and fiberglass boats. Being a president for only a couple of years, I was fortunate enough with Max Spencer, who helped us win the top award of all companies at AMF, of which there were 47, including AMF Bowling, Harley-Davidson, and many others. So it was quite an award with a $20,000 bonus, for which I was very pleased. But I was looking to join a company in which I could grow. The president of this company said he was not going to expand anymore in the boat business, was going to build cigarette machines. Is that better? Was going to build cigarette machines. Well, of course, that's not what I wanted. And after 3 years in the freezing cold, I looked and called an acquaintance of mine, Dick Gent in Sarasota, Florida. I went down, interviewed. They offered me a job through Castle Jordan, so I took the job at half the pay, but I saw a future in Wellcraft. We had a very dynamic team, including Bill Erickson, who's here tonight, Bill Mudgett, who's here, Gus Anastasi, who's here, Boyd Andrews, who passed away, and Max Spencer, I mentioned, and a young attorney at the time, Steve Herb, among others. So, with the help of that team, we did things like Bill Erickson tying us up with Miami Vice, which did great things for us, and we got into offshore racing, which Gus Anastasi helped out tremendously, and we began winning all races, including the world championship. And then, most importantly, Stephen arrived. So So you see, every time we moved, we had another baby. So we quit moving. Okay, when we started, we were only doing about $15 million in sales a year. And you see by the chart, we took it at approximately $300 million. Quite a ride. At this point, I'd like for Bill Erickson to take over and kind of explain what we did and how we did it. Part of it from an article in Powerboat Magazine. So, Bill, if you take over for a bit here.
Am I supposed to put that on my head, Michael?
You want to stand or sit?
Stand.
I know.
Well, as Bob said, I'm Bill Erickson, and I had 19 unbelievably great years with our 80th birthday boy, Bob Long. When we ran the company, we were a very, very small Sarasota company. I was there in 1975 when I started, 1 year before Bob, and that January, we did our first $1 million month. The company was actually started from a guy named Castle Jordan and Dick Genth, Dick was the president of Formula, Thunderbird Formula in Miami, and there was a buyout planned for that company, which Castle and Dick were involved with. They were trying to buy Thunderbird. Well, it turned out Alliance Machinery ended up buying it, and Castle and Dick couldn't get the company. So they came to Sarasota and they bought Wellcraft, which was a defunct boat company built in the 50s, started in the 50s. And when I started in 75, we did our first $1 million month. And that's hard to believe, considering we took this company to the third largest builder in the world and did $300 million in sales. Well, that's when I met Bob Long. Bob came in 1 year after me, and he became the guy that Castle Jordan was grooming for president as the company matured. So the story is really interesting because Bob became my mentor and we had a phenomenal relationship, not only just between the two of us and the senior staff. The senior staff of Wellcraft consisted of me, Bill Erickson, Senior VP of Sales and Marketing, and Max Spencer, Senior VP of Finance. Boyd Andrews, who passed away a number of years ago, was in charge of manufacturing. But we also had some very, very significant players that are here tonight. One is Bill Mudgett. Bill and Pat Mudgett were so instrumental in our growth, and so was Gus Anastasi, and Gus is here with his wife, Riley. But this was an amazing group of people. One of the things that I really enjoyed about working with Bob Long was his feeling. He made us feel like Wellcraft was really an entrepreneurial business and that we ran it. And we did. We ran it. This group of people here that still from Wellcraft, and Castle Jordan, who was the president of Aegis Corporation at the time, he allowed us to do pretty much anything we wanted to do. And Bob, I was a little bit kind of a weird guy. I like to do a lot of wild things, and Bob always backed me. And, you know, it goes all the way back to our dealer meetings. You know, we used to have, Wellcraft had the most memorable dealer meetings in the country. It was an honor for a dealer to come to our meetings. And our budgets got really out of control. But we took this company in a fairly short period of time. In the 80s, we were the third largest builder in the world. And we were doing, like Bob just said earlier, we were doing about $300 million in sales. And what I always liked about Bob was when I would come up with these ideas as a marketing guy, he would always back me. He backed me all the time. And we did a promotion that was probably one of the most significant promotions ever done in the marine industry. And that's when Bob and I put the Scarabs on Miami Vice. Now, if you remember the show, it was the biggest hit that's ever hit the United States on a television. Can you imagine 10 o'clock on Friday night and everybody in the country was watching Miami Vice? Well, the stars of Miami Vice were actually Don Johnson and Philip Michael Thomas. But in our group, the star was the 38 Scarab KV. This is a picture of the boat that we used in the series Miami Vice. And, you know, like Bob asked me to keep this under an hour, so I can't tell you all the side stories and the back stories that are involved with this whole deal. But it became probably the most revered marketing program ever done in our industry. It led us to other TV shows and movies. You know, when you're in the marketing business, what you try to do is you try to do, you know, these things that you see a bag of, in a movie, somebody has a bag of groceries in a movie and they got a big bag of Fritos in there. Well, that is the kind of marketing that we were doing with Miami Vice. But the whole point of that was every time we would come up with an idea, Bob always backed us. And he was absolutely the most fun guy I've ever worked with in my lifetime. I've completely lost track of these notes. But what we would do in the morning when we would come to work, we would start with our staff meeting at Wellcraft in Bob's office. And the senior staff would meet, and we would go over all the things that we're working on and what we were going to do and all the things that we plan on doing down the road. And then we would take it, like Bill Mudgett would take it to his group, and he was the VP of sales, and he would take it and transmit all the information that we were working on and try to make sure that everybody in the company felt the same way and were working for the same goal. The most significant thing that we did, in my opinion, was our grasp on the marketplace. You know, Bob would say, you know, we would go into these recessions, and you know, if you're in the boat business, you have no idea what the downturns were like. It was all the time. And we would have things I remember most were the strategy sessions that we would have. We would have strategy sessions at all hours. We'd have them at 7 o'clock at night. We'd have them at 8 o'clock in the morning on Saturday. And we would sit there and we would try to figure out, what are we going to do now that this market is sort of collapsing? So how are we going to keep Wellcraft going, and what were we going to do? Well, one of the things we did when the gas crisis hit, we started a company called Starwind. Starwind was, believe it or not, a sailboat company. And, you know, at the time, it worked out. It kept our people busy. It developed a really nice boat. The Jim Taylor's designs were awesome, and Starwind were some beautiful sailboats. But as soon as the gas came back, people stopped sailing. It's too much work. And I remember Boyd Andrews came up with this idea of, like I said, in our strategy meetings, we had things that worked and we had things that didn't work so well. But Boyd's hot button was this portable hotels in airports. And we spent all this money. Well, we didn't really. Fortunately, Boyd's people that he was working with on this concept, they absorbed most of the costs. But we built these little cubicles where you could, can you imagine going to O'Hare Airport and saying, oh, I've got 4 hours between my next flight, so I'm going to go into this little cubicle with a bed and a place for my computer to work and all this? Well, guess what? It flopped. So.
They started using it too many illegal things. Yeah.
So, am I that funny, Michael? This sort of reminds me of a dealer meeting when Bob would introduce me at a dealer meeting, and you know, we had the most spectacular dealer meetings in the history of the marine industry. We would have 55 boats in the water at the Sarasota Hyatt. I mean, it was unbelievable. We rewarded our dealerships with a phenomenal, fun time in Sarasota. One of the things that was critical to our development, though, really, was our teamwork and how much I'm looking for this quote that I'm supposed to read. I'm not doing so well up here, am I? I actually made a copy of this. I was supposed to read it. But let me paraphrase it. It was... I found it. It's here.
We just did that thing where you sit down, you bunk heads.
I think I'm supposed to put that lampshade on my head, really. But, you know, I was over at Bob's house the other day, and I said, well, Bob, what do you want me to say? And I said, well, he said, well, you know, Bill, you got to really be careful. I don't want this to sound like something that really is more than it really is. However, I got to tell you, this man is one of the most unbelievable leaders in the industry. And Mark Spencer, who worked for Powerboat Magazine for years, wrote this article when Bob was named Entrepreneur of the Decade. And that was a major deal. But here's what Bob said about why Wellcraft was so successful. If you ask Bob Long why Wellcraft has been so successful, he'd answer without a moment's hesitation that the credit goes to the team, which includes rank and file employees, middle management, and all the people nationwide who comprise the company's dealer network. And that is Bob Long. And Bob did a marvelous job of steering Wellcraft. I mean, this guy was like the Donald Trump of Wellcraft. And since I've lost my place, I'm just gonna go ahead and just freeform this. Because I know this I know this family so well. We spent so many, you know, it wasn't all work. We had lots of fun together, too, over the 19 years that we worked together. The senior staff of this company worked together for 19 years. That's unheard of in this industry. And when the companies in the industry that were our major competitors, back in the 70s and the 80s, all the boat companies were run by entrepreneurs. You had Sea Ray, Connie Ray, Bayliner, Orrin Edson, and Cobalt, Pack St. Clair, Grady White, Eddie Smith. It goes on and on. But one thing that Castle Jordan and Bob Long did for us is he made us feel as though this was a totally entrepreneurial dealer. I mean, entrepreneurial company. We felt we were with Wellcraft. We were Wellcraft. And it went all the way down to the hourly workers. Everybody had this spirit of continuity that Bob provided and Bob created. And that's why Wellcraft was so successful. And a meteoric rise, whatever I'm saying. And I just owe so much to this man and what I learned from him. And I'm still in the boat business. I run a boat dealership that I started 23 years ago. And I use so many of the ideas and thoughts of Bob Long in my daily work in my company, of my own company. And anyway, I just want to thank the man so much. And happy birthday, Bob.
Thank you, Bill. It kind of did give me a big head. But we did become friends over the years. And we, as a matter of fact, would play tennis almost every day at noon. And we took a lot of trips with our wives to the Bahamas and so on. So it was a really good run. Great time. But what happened? We were doing so well, everything was going good, but then the luxury tax came along. And the luxury tax literally killed the boating business, and I mean just all of them. I was forced to eliminate most of the senior staff, and it ended up the board of directors and Irwin Jacobs let me go. There I was, 53 years old, without a job, with no income, and so with the help of my family, I looked around everywhere in Florida for something in the boat business. I happened to find a small company, Marine Concepts, in Cape Coral, Florida. A little company that was broke. But I'd work with them, and since I knew boats and I knew engineering, and we wanted to be in Florida, I bought the company from Kiko Villalone, who was running it then. And basically, it was given to me because the company was losing money. By the first month in business, after I'd paid all past due bills, we ran out of money. I called a good friend of mine in the business, a dealer, Buck Pegg, Chaparral, and said, okay, if he could prepay his project so I could make payroll, I'd give him top priority. And he did, and I did, and we made it through. Again, we built an excellent team and began expanding very fast. I bought two plants in Cape Coral, and I bit the bullet and made a giant leap and bought the old Wellcraft facility, which I had built in Sarasota. Over 300,000 square foot and 30 acres. And that was a big jump, but it certainly paid off. because the team there we had, we began expanding very fast. Through great teamwork, dedication, and cooperation, we rapidly grew to be the top tooling company in the United States. So when I hit 76 years old, even though I was very happy, I decided it was time for me to bow out. I found a pretty good company who bought us, but we weren't entirely happy with the company. And luckily that company, a year or so, sold again to what is now Patrick Industries. That's not my son, Patrick. They continue to do very well, and both my sons, John, and my son, Kevin, continue to work for them. I'm happy to say that everything seems to be working out very fine for everyone. Now you see what an interesting life Karen and I have had and are having. We are happy, we love our family, and we love all of you. And we are so happy for you to be here to celebrate my 80th birthday. Thank you all very much. Enjoy the slideshow for a little bit here.
Thanks everyone for coming tonight. It's not over yet. We can all just hang out. We got more drinks, more food. And please have fun and enjoy yourself.
Happy birthday, Uncle Bob. I just want to thank you from all of the Kern family with your representatives here, Katie and Ellie, for being such a wonderful uncle and always making it fun wherever we go when you are there. We think of Big River and all the scavenger hunts and all the fun prizes that you had for me and then for my kids when we'd come to Big River. And just thank you for always being who you are and just loving us for who we are.
Happy birthday. We love you.
Bob.
Happy 80th birthday, Bob. This is from me and from your sister Gina.
Happy birthday from your baby sister.
And your son-in-law.
Happy birthday, Robert.
Wait a minute, that's not right. Brother-in-law.
Okay, we're here anyway.
And your other brother-in-law.
And your other brother-in-law. The one that didn't grow up with you, like the other brother-in-law. Your sisters think a lot of you. They talk really, really special about you.
Another 80 years.
You know, Bob, how special you are to me and always have been. I mean, without you, my life would have been totally different. Wouldn't have my husband.
Yeah, right. We got to say that for sure.
Right.
Yeah, you've always been behind me, and thank you very much.
So thank you for all you've done for me, and I love you so much. And I hope you have many more happy years together with your family. Bye.
Love you, Bob.
Love you. Yeah.
Happy birthday, Bob.
Happy birthday, Grandpa!
Well, happy birthday, Dad, from Patrick and I. Hi. We want to say, you know, you've been an inspiration to us. You know, first off, thank you for being born 80 years ago, because I wouldn't exist without you. But in all seriousness, no, you really are. You know, things, your dedication to the family and to mom, and what you do for us, and as me as a dad, and now my kids. I do thank you, and you know, we're happy that we're hanging out and doing this.
So, it's been said that true success is determined not by the car we drive, the house we live in, or the job we have, but rather by the relationships that we have with the people that are closest to us. And I'm very happy to be back in Florida, and very grateful to be able to spend the time with both you and Mom. And I think you are a success, Dad. And that's evidenced by all the people that are here tonight, the people that are closest to you. So, happy birthday.
We love you, Uncle Bob.
We love you, Uncle Bob. And I just want to tell you that we really enjoy you, and we are very grateful that you're in our lives. And the other thing that I want to say is you've taught our whole generation the idea of being humble. And we're all grateful for that. Thank you. We love you. Happy birthday.
So, firstly, I want to say, Dad, thank you for bringing us into this world. He brought us into this world in 1970. So that is almost 50 years ago. I'm 49 today. And I got to say, I'm very, very happy. Everything you've done for me. And thank you. It's a wonderful party. And looking forward to the next decade with you.
Well, 1969 for me. And happy birthday, Dad. I did my speech already with my
What do you else you want to say? Come on.
And I
say something, Michelle. How about how much you love him?
I love you, Dad, so much. Happy birthday.
I love you, Dad, too.
Yay, we love you, Dad.
And yeah, I was born in 65.
65. Woo! All right. Oh, Steven, get over here. Get over here. Look, we have Steven. Steven, when were you born?
I was born in 1981.
Oh, shut up. Get out of here. Get out of here, Steven. Oh, we got Kevin. Look. Hey, Dad, look who we have. You got to say something nice.
Got ourselves a whole family here.
Say something nice to Dad.
I already said hi.
Say something else.
I said the same thing. Say hi again.
Hi.
So,
hi, Dad. I'm Kevin.
And what are you going to say to Dad? Nice word to Dad?
I love you.
Oh, he loves him. Oh, we got Patrick. Patrick, I say something nice to Dad.
Okay. Happy birthday, Dad. And if you want to bid on the boat, you call Carter Moody Telethon 366-7889. You can bid on this 16-foot American. So call now.
Yay! Okay, let's sing a song. We love you, Dad. Oh, yes, we do.
We do.
Oh, yes, we do.
All right, what do you say?
All right, good times. Okay. All right, everyone.
Happy birthday, Dad.
Happy birthday, Dad. Have a good night. We love you.
Dad. We love you.
We are introducing man number one for the evening, Bob Long. So excited. Oh, my goodness. Excuse me, boys. Keep it going. Did you show me man number two?
Oh, yeah, man number two.
Oh, now we're going to go to man number two.
Sorry.
Who just happens to be. Who is this one?
Oh.
Oh.
So. Oh. feel like Marilyn Monroe.
She is so hot with this, you know. I think that must be Hulk the Hogan. No, wait. I don't know who the hell it is. It doesn't really matter. Go Trump.
Happy birthday, Bob. Had such a great time. Bill and I definitely enjoyed ourselves. Probably a little too much, but all good.
Happy birthday, dear Bob. Dad. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Grandpa. From John Thomas.
And Bree.
And one of the things that you've said that stuck with me is that family's forever. So family's forever, and happy birthday.
Hi, Dad.
Hi, Dad.
We just was.
If we had these earlier, we probably would have safe sex.
And you wouldn't have any grandkids.
Yeah, because if we would have laid with these things, I don't know what the hell would have happened.
We're just excited to have these pillows at our bedside.
No, seriously, they're
I'm not
awesome.
Kidding. They're awesome.
They are really awesome.
Chris, are you excited to go to bed with this?
I might like to take a nap.
I can't wait. I get to go with my mommy and daddy.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.